Having no equip load means that they cannot use weapons, not even the Dark Hand or the Ghost Blade, and I heard they are pretty useful. I can't use shields, I can't use armors, that in this game can even be upgraded, making them insanely good, and I can't use sorceries or miracles, since staves and talismans have weight. So like, how am I going to beat the game? Well, I could punch my way through every boss fight while naked, but that would be boring and I'm not good enough to do it, so I guess I'll have to find a more interesting way. Even if we choose the deprived, we start with the straight sword hilt in our hands, that obviously has weight, so we might as well use the pyromancer and remove the armor along with the sword as we begin. That way we can get and equip the pyromancy hand, because since it's our actual hand being on fire, I think, it doesn't have weight, and with that we can barbecue the demon using fireballs. Yeah, this game doesn't have the best hitboxes. Our starting gif is the master key, since this is Dark Souls 1 and I don't think there are any other options. And with that we can traverse Undead Burg and get the black firebombs we find in this chest. Because if you are familiar with Elden Ring or Dark Souls 3, or Demon Souls I guess, you are used to a focus bar that allows you to cast spells, but in this game we have a fixed amount of uses for every attuned spell. And with just 8 fireballs and no way to obtain more pyromancies, we don't have enough damage to defeat the Taurus Demon. But since equipped items don't have weight, we can use them to push him over the edge. On that regard, we could also have just fought him near the broken part of the bridge, and he will fall down sometimes. After fighting Mr. Del Toro, we can feel what it's like going outside at any time during the day, and then if we run faster than a boar, we can meet lovely Andre. That has nothing we need since we can't upgrade the flame this way, but around here we can find equally lovely Lothric that will independently decide to give us his ring. Smiley face. This is because in this game rings don't have weight, and they have no idea why is that, but I'm not going to complain, because without rings you can't actually beat the game. Not because it's hard, you actually like need a specific one at some point. We would like to work with some more spells, but to do that we have to first defeat the Capra Demon, and this fight can be tough, since the arena is really small and there are two dogs inside, just hanging out. Sure, we could defeat him from outside the fog by throwing firebombs at a specific angle, but this is a moment as good as any to mention that I won't be using glitches and it's going to be an all bosses run, and that you can subscribe because of that. I had to buy a couple of firebombs from a vendor, and then we can enter the fight, where we have to survive the initial onslaught by dodging them at first, and then running on top of the stairs, and if we get a little lucky we will have an opening where we can focus the dogs. We may have to run up and then fall down a couple of times during the fight, but it's still the early stages of the game, so we won't take that much damage even if we get hit while we don't have an armor, and once the dogs are dealt with, we can keep on circling around and freely hit the demon, so the fight is basically over. Now we have the key to the depths, where we can free Laurentius, that will not only let us buy a couple more spells, but will also let us upgrade the flame, that doesn't require upgrade materials, but only an ungodly amount of souls, meaning that we won't be leveling up for a bit. We can try out the new spell against the Bell Gargoyles, and I wasn't sure if it was going to be easy since they can spew fire, but it turns out that combustion will stagger them after only 2 hits, and they will stay staggered for, well, about the time we take to cast combustion twice. So nothing to worry about here, and we ring the first bell. Next in line is Pinwheel, that we can easily reach by falling down a couple of cliffs. We want to defeat him now to have more Estus Flask charges, and I know that it's considered a joke fight, but to give him some credit, it's because this way it's easily doable by characters fresh out of the tutorial, and I know we aren't quite in that category power-wise, but it still wasn't a 2-hit kill, it took like 8 at least. I then decided to go after the butterfly, because it's probably going to be an easy fight, and since we are going to need to do it eventually, might as well take the souls now. And hitbox issues aside, if we manage to not fall asleep while we wait for it to finally decide to rest on the bridge, it's going to be basically free. I mean, maybe the laser kills us in one hit if we get caught while rolling, but just like, avoid doing that and you'll be good. We would like to get to the second bell, but since Quelaag is immune to fire damage, we are going to need something more to defeat her. And no, I'm not going to summon NPCs in this run either. So first we can go to this vendor and buy literal dung, that will deal toxic buildup, and then we have to go to the Valley of Drakes and climb down Blight Town to reach her. If we do it without stopping at bonfires, it's going to be easier, because we can just go back with a homeward bone, and climbing this place back up is much worse, but obviously this means that if we die, we have to climb down again. Once we reach her, we have to throw the dung, and it took me 29 out of the 30 I brought to toxic her, but I think that the longer we take to use them, the more we will need, so results may vary. Thankfully, with just one toxic trigger, we will deal her full HP bar worth of damage, but it's a very slowly damaging toxic, so it will take a lot, and while we wait, we have to dodge some attacks, but like, the only way we can die is if we get trapped by her magma, that will linger on the ground for a long time, so we need to keep an eye out for that, and we can either punch her or use throwing knives to speed up the process. After she's out of the way, we can break an invisible wall, meet Angie, and join the Servants of Chaos Covenant, that will immediately award us with the Chaos Fireball, a very good spell. Angie could sell us some pyromancies, but he will only do it if we get infected by some worms that will grow an egg on our head, and it costs a bunch of souls to do, but even if it was free, it's extremely disgusting, so no way that I'm doing that. I am protecting you from seeing how it looks like. Also, yeah, we can get rid of the worms with the egg vermifuge, but all the people in Blight Town started taking them as soon as they placed turned into a poison swamp to apparently heal themselves, so there's a shortage. Around the corner we can fight Ceaseless Discharge, and the fight begins as soon as we take this item. It would be very hard fighting fairly, but if we just wait for his first attack to miss and then run to the entrance, he's going to jump to get us, get the jump wrong, since lore-wise he's like a kid, and we'll just be there hanging on top of this cliff helplessly. So if we hit him 6 times, he will fall and die. All of this to explain that it's not a glitch, it's an intended mechanic in the game, and we can bone out since I didn't stop at any bonfire. Now we need the last couple of upgrades before we can leave Lower Lordran, and first of which is freeing Griggs, that will sell us a ring that improves sorcery damage by 20%. And you may wonder why I am talking about something that improves sorceries, but it's because it improves pyromancies too, as we can see on this test damage dummy. And no, it's not written anywhere in the game. Then we can go and fight the Gaping Dragon, that could have been a problem since it's really tanky, but at this point we have enough attunement slots that we can just take it down at a distance with no problem. Also, it will give us 20k souls while Quelaag only gives us 20k, and you usually can only meet her after the dragon. I still have to understand why. Here we can go down back to Blight Town, because we can find a spell that... Because after killing this strange enemy, we can find a spell that is just wrong. It's obviously Power Within, and this game's version of Power Within is the reason why it's really weak in the following ones. Because among other things, we will deal 40% more damage from all sources. Yeah, 40, 40, you heard that right. And it works with spells, weapons, everything. The downside is that it lasts for 100 seconds and we lose 1% of our total HP per second. But like, we can just heal. At this point we upgraded the flame to +10, meaning that the Chaos Witch will spawn in the swamp and we can buy greater combustion from her, along with upgrading the flame even more. With the power of fire and inexperienced game balance in our hands, we can make our way through Sand's Fortress, and I still remember how to do that 10 years later. Well, mostly. The rock is still funny though. A couple of swinging axes and a giant later, and we can fight the golem, and I will show you why Power Within is broken. I don't even need commentary or cuts. Yeah. We land in Einor Londo. Here we have to do some actual parkour to proceed. And remember that if you have any problems with the archers, you can just parry them forehead. And I know I said I wouldn't use glitches, but like, allow me to get through the area this way. I honestly don't even remember the last time that I went through the intended path. Here we have to fight Ornstein and the other guy, that are probably the reason most people dropped and will drop the game. After four directional rolling, of course. But we came prepared. At first I had to get the spacing right, because its boxes aren't the best here, and we can end up missing most of the attacks. And then we can use power within, but we can't quite run in aggressively all the time, because if our timing is bad, we are going to die in 2 versus 1. That said, if we manage to block the executioner behind a pillar, or we just see an opening, we can go nuts with Great Combustion and take down Orstein in a very short time. This way, we can fight Smosh, okay, let's go with Smosh. He's Anthony Padilla now, happy? If we fight Smosh in phase 2, it's going to be much easier, because his attacks are, yes, very dangerous, but also quite slow. And since our casting time is also slow, we can end up in a difficult situation against faster enemies like Orstein. Now that they are gone, we get the Lord Vessel, meaning we can start to teleport around. So I started running all over the place. First of all, I went to the lake in the woods to take down the Hydra, that I was scared was going to be a nightmare, but actually fireballs work very well, and after doing that we can go up the ladder near the waterfall to circumvent the door that leads to Sif, because I didn't want to spend the 20k souls to get the key, and I for sure didn't want to harm Andre. The fight against Sif is pretty easy at this point. We can just stand under her head, and we can connect with Great Combustion while the sword attacks will miss us most of the time, so we just have to roll under her again if she decides to jump away a couple of times, and with that we get the Covenant of Artorias, the ring that, as I said before, is needed to beat the game. With these souls we can also upgrade the flame to the Ascended Flame, meaning that hundreds of thousands of souls later we still have to upgrade it 5 more times. But we are almost done, and we can start to tackle the 4 lords. First in line is Sif, where after almost dying, then actually dying, breaking out of jail, getting lost, and walking on invisible stuff, we can fight him. What scared me the most here was the curse, because since we don't have armor, all our resistances are really low. But if we get poison or toxic, it's not a problem. If we get cursed, we die on the spot and halve our HP until we break the curse. We could increase resistance to it by having more humanity or by being in human form, but we can also just try and be a little more careful. He's immune to damage until the crystal in the arena breaks, but if we let him break it, he will be staggered for a long time, meaning that if we get a little lucky after that and he does the wrong attack, we can take him down in a very short time by just spamming the Great Combustion and hitting a Chaos Fireball a couple of frames before blowing up for good. One lord done, and we can proceed down, where before we can face the boss, we have to climb up a ladder in a church and meet an NPC. But if the phantoms here decide that you're going to die, you're going to die. Not much you can do about it. If you manage to reach the guy, you get the key to unflood the place, and you remember that you could have just killed him with firebombs from below the church without having to climb. Now we can go and fight the original Godskin duo. They will spawn a couple of seconds after you fall and always in the same position. So, if you don't remember how to get there early, you just have to die as soon as the fight begins in the previous try because you missed the roll input. The first problem is that we need a ring to walk on the floor here, meaning that we have to ditch a good 20% damage increase that comes from the other ring, and the fight is going to take a long time since they will slowly spawn. So power within will eventually end and we will lose 40% more damage. Also, we usually fight them by putting on the heaviest armor we can find and just standing near them spamming attacks, and we obviously can't do it in this run. That said, if we are really close we won't take much damage since their heal will hit us, and I think that power within improves our defense too, but I'm not 100% sure. So we basically fight like we have Havel's armor on, and we just heal a bit more often, hoping that they won't use too many grab attacks. 3 kings out of the way, and we can go even deeper into the catacombs, falling the same way we did before to reach Pinwheel, and then I spent close to an hour lost in these dark catacombs, because there are 3 ways to make light in this game and all of them require equipping some weight. And also because when I replay the game I usually get to Orstein and Smosh and that's it. We reach Rave Lord Nito, and this is probably the hardest fight so far, because we have no way to permanently kill his skeletons, and it's another one of those fights that you would want to do in full Havel armor, just standing there swinging. To defeat him, we want to get close enough to trigger a melee attack, dodge it, and spam spells until we get interrupted by either him or the skeletons. If we get a little the lucky, Nito will be the one constantly killing his skeletons. If that happens, we can dish out enough damage to kill him in a very short time. Just remember to never go beyond the initial area of the arena, or else many more skeletons will aggro on us and the fight will be much harder. Now only one lord remains, and after dodging some demons and some statues, we can fight the demon fire sage. Don't get fooled by him, his attacks are magic and not fire, and I'm pretty sure he isn't resistant to fire damage even if he's literally burning. So we don't have to prepare in any particular way, we just have to get close, use a couple of combustions and roll away when he tries to do some of his slow attacks. After the fire sage though, there is a much harder fight, because the centipede demon is immune to fire damage, so once again we have to rely on the dung, and a good tip on this fight is lowering the brightness that you had to turn up in the catacombs section. So the strategy is to toxic him, that will be enough to take him down, and then just dodge attacks until he falls, with the occasional throwing knife to speed up the process. And I could show you more of this fight, but the camera has a horrible shake the whole time that almost makes me motion sick, so let's cut it short. The centipede drops us a ring that allows us to walk on lava without taking much damage, and no, this ring isn't mandatory to beat the game. But now we have to fight the Bed of Chaos, a boss fight so bad that the actual game developers said that they were sorry and that they messed it up. The fight is a gimmick, we have to break two seals at the edges of the arena first, and then you can hit the actual boss, but the floor will start to break along the way and the hitboxes are really bad. There is a way to break both seals with firebombs if you have a specific lineup and aim true, but honestly I don't remember it, so I just run on the edge of the arena and jump the gaps, because a thing that comes to a raid here is that every time one of them is broken it won't be restored even if we die, so we can just quit out, respawn outside the fog, come back in and go for the other one, and at the end we can break a couple of roots and take down the slug of chaos with a punch. It may be immune to fire damage, I'm not sure. Now the lords are done, but we have to clean up a couple of enemies before we venture into the DLC. So first we go into crow mode to go back to the asylum, where we can fight the stray demon part 3, and at this point we know how to fight them. But here we can also find a doll that we can use to get into the painting of Eriamis, where after some shenanigans with half dragons we can fight Priscilla. As soon as we hit her she turns invisible, and you can use a couple of throwing knives on her, because you'll be able to see them floating in the air, but like I forgot. We have such low resistances that we bleed every time we get hit, but still we don't take that much damage. She returns visible the moment we stagger her, but our damage is so high that she will die before that. And I'm thankful, because I spent so much time on the internet that I'm afraid I should censor her feet, or her armpits. Same thing goes for Gwyndolin, honestly, but I hope that the distance and the snakes will keep people away. This fight is a bit weird, in that we don't have actual openings to hit, we just have to run forward dodging attacks and the boss will teleport away, so we need to get a bit luck with the teleport cycles in order to deal damage, but there are only 3 attacks we have to dodge, so it's not going to be a problem. Also, the arena isn't infinite and it will end at some point. There is probably a bottomless hole joke here, but I can't find it. This was the last boss fight in the base game, so we can enter what scares me the most, the DLC. We first have to go behind the Hydra, where we can free Princess Dusk. I don't have to play the whole thing again, right? After a small panic attack, I went to get the pendant found in a golem in the archives, and we can enter the DLC even if Dusk is dead. And I'd say thank Gwyn for that, or else the video probably wouldn't have come out. As soon as we enter the DLC, we have to fight the Sanctuary Guardian, the main reason why I waited so long to do it. Because this fight can be horrible, in that the Guardian can decide to just fly around for a bit, and if he doesn't want to land, there is nothing you can do. Well, maybe I waited too much, because our damage was insane here, and 3-4 fireballs later the Guardian is done. We then have to avoid the Gardeners, and we can fight the face of the DLC and maybe the game, Knight Artorias. We need to be really aggressive, because if power within ends the fight will be a nightmare, and sometimes he will dodge away a couple of times and start to charge up. While he's charging he will take less damage, and to take him out of it we have to deal enough damage, or else he will power up and will be much more aggressive. We can barely do it reliably if we rush towards him and spam 3 Great Combustion or 2 Combustion and a Chaos Fireball. Anything else and we won't be able to do it. Also, we need to be aggressive because he is aggressive and we can't reliably just run away. Rolling behind him and then walking around him to dodge his follow-up attack while we cast is probably the best strategy, and here is where we start to see a big advantage we have with casting in this game. It doesn't cost stamina, so we can make risky attacks and still roll away after. All that allows us to take down the knight, but unfortunately this is not the hardest fight in the game, so we have to proceed down in the city and even deeper to find Manus. Usually here we should get an item that allows us to reflect his spells, but that item is behind a weird illusory wall that we can only open with a light source. Too bad that to light it we can use a sorcery, but all the staves have weight. There's a hat and a lantern too, but they are all equipped items, so no silver pendant for us. The Daddy of the Abyss is tied for the hardest fight in the game, and we can see it clearly in this challenge. One misstep and we are dead. All the big spells and combos will take us out on the spot, but also most other attacks will deal enough damage to put us in a situation where we might have to roll a couple of times and hope he doesn't get too aggressive so that we can heal. What comes to our aid here is the character build I did, because after getting to 30 vigor, leveling attunement a bit and upgrading the flame to the max, I dumped all the souls I found on dexterity, because there actually is a casting speed mechanic in the game that scales up to 45 dexterity, and the added speed really helps us out against his fast attacks. I mean, if the wikis are correct and this is true, because there are a lot of missing or straight up false information there. Wait, how is she alive? Did they break the time-space continuum? Well, I'll fix it then. We now have the other hardest fight in the game, and it's so hard that we have to ask a friend to shoot her out of the sky. I think I'll have to help him move next week though. Calamith is here, and it's not going to be easy. First of all, I couldn't bring the Chaos Fireball with me, because they cost 2 attunement slots for just 4 fireballs, and in this fight we are going to be really tight spell-wise, considering that for sure a couple of them will miss or will not register, and that since Calamith has a lot of HP, power within will eventually end, meaning that we could have theoretically 9 or 10 spare spells if we had a fast fight, but that can very easily become 2 or 3. And here consumable items like firebombs and throwing knives deal basically no damage. We want to be just below her mouth, because here she will mostly do breath attacks that will miss us and that last a lot, and they are all perfect openings to dish out a lot of free damage. For sure she will do other attacks, and if you are here they may be very tough to dodge, especially the charges and grabs. But even if they come out fast, she doesn't combo them together a lot, and since we can survive most attacks, we just have to get up and heal, or maybe dodge one more attack before healing, but that's it. And you may be wondering why I didn't get the dragon head or torso stone, that are pretty useful and substitute an armor that we couldn't wear either way, but it's because I would have to spend too much time farming dragon scales and no way I'm doing that. Now only Gwyn is left, but unfortunately for him, if we have the flame in one hand we can parry with the offhand, so his fate isn't that bright. Well, or it's too bright. And with that, I'll say that you can beat Dark Souls with no equip load. If you like the video, leave a like or even subscribe. I'll see you next time. Well, you'll see me. See the video at least. Why do I always mess up the outro? Wait a second, this was a pyromancy only run with extra steps!